It's Mrs. Hellinga again. I'm so excited to be with you today. Instead of starting out by showing you pictures of my kids like I did last time, I thought I would show you pictures of two new members of our family. A couple of weeks ago, we got two new kittens. So meet Willow and Nevis. Aren't they the sweetest? Today, we are going to talk about repentance. Now, this is a word that you've probably heard before, and you may even think you know what it means, but let's talk about it a little bit. The dictionary defines repentance as sincere regret or remorse. It means you feel really bad about something. But what does the Bible have to say about repentance? Does it say the same thing, or does it mean something different? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. Before we get started, let's rewind for a second and remind ourselves what we have been learning about lately. If you remember, we've talked about Jesus' crucifixion, how he rose from the dead, and how he spent 40 days on earth before he ascended into heaven. After Jesus went home to heaven, the apostles began to spread the good news. Last Sunday, Pastor Ben taught us the story about the lame beggar. I know, I can hear you guys laughing right now. Lame doesn't mean he was a boring, totally uncool guy. Lame means he was born unable to walk. Every day, this man was carried to the temple because, remember, he couldn't walk. He sat outside begging people for money. Scripture tells us that this man was a regular. He did this all of the time. So one day, Peter and John were on the way to the temple to pray when they came across the lame beggar. Now, Peter did not have any money to give the beggar, but he had something way better. Peter, with the authority and power of Jesus, healed the beggar. But his healing went far deeper than just fixing his body. Through Jesus, the beggar's soul was saved. Could you imagine a more perfect day? This man was practically doing cartwheels. He was so excited. Let's take a quick time out and think about this story. The beggar wanted money, never thinking he would be capable of working on his own. In those days, there weren't many jobs a man who couldn't walk could perform. God wanted to give him so much more than money. He wanted to give him healing. But first, the beggar needed to have faith in Jesus. Peter looked at the beggar, exclaiming through the power and authority of Jesus, "Walk!" Imagine what must have been going through this man's mind. He had never, ever walked. But since he often begged at the temple, he very likely knew who Jesus was and knew the stories of Jesus' healings. Jesus was telling the beggar to walk, and the beggar believed that Jesus could make that happen. What incredible faith! Imagine what God can do in our lives if we reach out to Him in faith. As you can imagine, this miracle created quite the stir, and there were many people around who were amazed at what had just happened. And Peter knew never to waste a good opportunity to spread the good news. The crowd gathered around Peter and he began to speak. First, he started with a hard truth. He told the crowd, "Jesus was killed because you and your leaders handed him over to Pilate, who would have let Jesus go, except you chose to free a murderer instead." Peter basically said the death of Jesus was both the Jews' fault and the Gentiles' fault. Yikes! What a way to start a speech! But Peter followed this hard truth with real compassion. He called them brothers. He said he knew they didn't do what they did on purpose because they didn't know any better. And he reminded them that nothing, not even their evil behavior towards Jesus, could stop God's plan. Remember, we all sin and make horrible mistakes sometimes, even Peter. Remember, he denied knowing Jesus 3 times in the hours leading up to Jesus' death. But Peter knew the people did not have to live in guilt and shame for what they had done. He knew God offered a better way. So what is this better way? Peter tells us in Acts chapter 3, verse 19. He says, "Repent then and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord." So according to Scripture, we need to repent and turn to God. Do you remember at the beginning of our lesson when we talked about what the dictionary defines repentance as? Basically, the dictionary said repentance is feeling really, really bad for something that you did. But biblical repentance is something much more. First, you have to stop what you're doing and admit that you are wrong. And second, you need to turn away from your sin. And third, you need to head straight towards God. I think these street signs are a nifty little way to remember what biblical repentance is. Stop what you're doing, turn away from your sin, head one way straight towards God. Let's see if an example will help. Let's say you have a little brother who drives you nuts. You find him incredibly annoying, so you're probably a little meaner to him than you should be, and you don't include him when you want to play. Lately, you feel as if the Holy Spirit is telling you that you need to be kinder to your brother. So what does repentance look like in this situation? First, you have to stop and admit what you were doing to your brother was wrong. Next, you have to turn away from your bad behavior and make a decision to act differently. And as you head towards God, you need to ask yourself, how would God want you to treat your brother? Biblical repentance offers us some great benefits. First, when we repent, we are forgiven. Praise God. We are also refreshed. Sin is so heavy when we carry it around. When we repent, God takes this away from us. Oh, and it feels so good. And we draw closer to God, right where we belong. Well, kids, we've come to the end of our lesson today. I hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. Today is Father's Day, so make sure to tell your dad that you love him and that you are thankful for him. I'll see you next time. The dead of
too.